Good morning. Hey, somebody sang it back to me. I appreciate that. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning to you.
Good morning to you.
Hey, I don't know, we're going to do a sing-along today. Welcome to homecoming, everybody. How many of you are excited about food today? That's a weak applause for food. Y'all must not know who cooked today. I know there's a Hershey bar cake waiting in the back. I know that. I'm real excited about that. Thank you, Brandon, for not eating that last night. God bless you for leaving some for the rest of us. It's so good to be here with you today. We're excited to be together with you. If you're a guest here today, we're super, super glad you're here. We know you probably came to see Cody. We promise it's coming. It's coming up. It's going to be great. We're getting a chance today, church, to hear from each other in story and in song, a chance to worship God together. I'm excited about what he's doing. But before we move forward, I want to introduce to you, we had a new family member in our church this last week. There is Joseph Roy Moore. You haven't seen that? That's Chris and Stacey's little bundle of joy, 9 pounds, 21 and a half inches long, because I know you ladies care about those kind of things. My wife asked me, I showed her the picture, did they say how big he was? I thought, I don't know how big he is. Who cares? But she apparently, ladies care about those sort of things. Yeah, he's about yay big. It's like a fishing tail. He was this big. He was bigger. But isn't he just precious?
He is.
I spoke to Chris yesterday. They're coming home from the hospital today, so they won't be with us. But in the upcoming weeks, they're looking forward to bringing them to the church, coming up on stage and holding them up for all of you to look at from afar. So, you know, maybe not close up, but from afar, you'll get to see them. Let me pray for us, and then we're going to dive in and worship the Lord together. Father, I'm so grateful to you for who you are, and for what you do in us and through us, and what you do as we gather together as your people. I pray that you would be present with us today, Jesus, as we worship you. God, as we come together as a group to lift up the name of Jesus, we be glorified in this place and draw all people to yourself. We thank you, God, for a chance to celebrate the body of Christ that we are here at Eaton Church. God, a prophecy. More than that, Jesus, we are honored to celebrate you today. Be glorified in our midst in what we say, what we do. Lord, you are first. I think about what Scripture says, that you are, that God gave you preeminence, that you might be the first among all things, that you were the head of the body of the church. So God, we glorify you as such. You're the head of this church. We thank you for the work you've done in our lives, and we worship you today. In Jesus' name, everybody say amen. Let's stand to our feet this morning. When I think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how he picked me up, still me around.
Thank you, Jesus, Lord.
You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is proud. Oh, you are here. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working.
Darkness, my God.
next part of service. Can we just declare that together? How great? How way maker. But that don't mean we still don't go through some storms that we've got to fight through. But you know, I want to sing a song this morning that says, your cries have awoken the master. Sometimes our cries have to awake the master. Sometimes it takes some desperate situations to get in tune with God. But y'all pray for us as we move into this situation here. And you move into your situation that you're facing today, your cries will awake the master.
Thank you. Glennis refuses to let me bring my dog to church as my emotional support animal, so I have a duck that she gave me. So, bear with me. James 1, 2 through 4 tells us that when troubles of any kind come our way to consider them an opportunity to see who's talking. Consider them great joy, for you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance will have a chance to grow. So let it grow, for when your endurance is fully developed, you will be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. For several years, I have been waiting for God to fulfill a promise I believe with all my heart that He made to me. And through the time of believing and waiting, I have been hurt and I have made some bad choices. But this summer, I was walking through the parking lot to my office one morning, and it hit me so powerfully that God has never let me fall. He has never let me go without anything. He's just never left my side. God is good and God is faithful always. One thing I hear said frequently from women who have been through the same challenge is that I would not asked to do it again, but I would never give back anything that I have learned through it. And I think that same thing is said through many people who have gone through trials in their life, illness and injury and cancer. People have always just, if they've leaned on God, they have grown in their faith and they've learned stuff that they will never ever want to give back. My first hero of faith taught me the same lesson through the trials that I watched him go through. When he was 25 years old, my brother was injured, and he was a diesel mechanic, and he was crushed under a scissors lift and left paralyzed from his waist down. A couple years after that accident, he had testicular cancer, and that spread to his liver. He ended up spending the rest of his life battling one problem after another, including a stroke when he was 40, broken bones, and complications that resulted from his injury. His own sheer stubbornness to refuse to sit down and behave like every paralyzed person should do. At 50, he passed away from esophageal cancer. He was a hunter. He would climb mountains that I couldn't climb, and he would just do things that most people with the use of their legs would not do. I spent those 25 years between his accident and his death watching him and wondering how he always seemed to come through out of it so much stronger than he ever was. I watched him rise up from every trial stronger than he was before. He would always tell me that he would never go back and change anything, and now I understand it. I've learned why, and others have learned why. They will never go back. And I wouldn't either. Levi Lesko is a lead pastor at the Fresh Life Church in Montana. He and his wife lost their 5-year-old daughter to an asthma attack several years ago. He wrote a book about it and what he learned through it. In his book, he says you need to be actively on the lookout for every way you can redeem the hell that you were put through by shining your light out of the darkness. Your suffering is being used to create an anointing oil for the next level God wants you to reach. Squeeze every drop of your trial. Let nothing be wasted. Hold nothing back. None of your tears have fallen to the ground unseen. God has planned to put each of your difficulties to use like a seed that goes into the ground and brings forth the harvest of righteousness. We all have trials in our life, and it's true what James said, the testing is a gift. The thought is repeated through the scriptures, Zechariah, 1 Peter, Isaiah, Malachi, Job, Proverbs, and Psalms all speak of how we go through trials so that we can be refined. Today I am, by the grace of God, stronger than I have ever been. I am happier. I am more content with my life than I have ever thought I would be. When my world started to shake, I remember sitting on my front porch swing and praying that God would draw me nearer to Him. I wanted to see my faith increase. I started to immerse myself in things I knew were good and faith builders. I went to a diehard country music fan to a sold-out fan of Christian music. I bought Bible studies and I worked diligently through them. I became more and more interested in my Bible. My prayer life became a priority in my days. I listened to sermons on YouTube from faith leaders such as Louis Giglio, Jensen Franklin, Craig Rochelle, Levi Lesko, Karen Wheaton, my favorite, and Stephen Furtick. And I started reading great inspirational books. One of the favorite authors has become Bob Sorge. He is walking through his own trial. He is a church pastor who suffered a traumatic injury to his throat during a routine surgery, and he lost his voice. He can only speak now in a whisper, and every word he says is painful. But God has given him the gift to be able to use his pain and his trial to write some wonderful books. In his book, God is Still Writing Your Story, he writes, "Waiting on God is one of the most controversial things you can do. Everyone will agree it's important that you wait on God, but nobody will agree how you are actually supposed to do it. Everybody agrees on the principle, nobody agrees on the implementation." And that is so true. Waiting will demand every resource in your being. It's one of the most violent things you will ever do. You will require focus, intensity, and tenacity. When you're waiting on God, you aggressively are putting pressure on the kingdom of God. A couple weeks ago, when Adam asked me to do this, I wasn't sure I would do it. And this morning, he still wasn't sure I would do it. And he was trying to give me a pep talk. And he said that the reason he asked me was because he's read some of the stuff that I have written and shared with the girls. And so he just really thought I could do it. And so about an hour ago, I threw away the last two pages that I was going to speak. And I went home and I got something that I had written that Lynn told me that I should read. So I'm going to read that now. And it's kind of inspired by that stubborn brother of mine who refused to sit down and behave. He went to Africa twice to do big game hunts and just talked about I could stand up here all day and tell you about things that my brother did that he shouldn't have done, only through the grace of God. So this is called The Hunted Becomes the Hunter. "So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and I will help you. I will hold you in my righteous right hand." That's from Isaiah 40:31. In Africa, big game hunters in the 19th and 20th centuries have given the name the Big Five to the five most difficult and most dangerous animals to hunt. The mighty lion has earned the title King of the Beast, and he heads up the group with his thunderous roar and his magnificent mane that he wears as a crown. There's a stealthy and mysterious leopard, seldom ever seen, but moves like a ghost in the night. Next comes a gigantic elephant whose strength and power are rarely challenged by for no other reason than he is the largest land mammal on earth, and he can do away with his attackers with the same ease as we humans swat a fly. And he probably has better aim with his trunk than I do with fly swatter. The white rhino is in a group because of his size and his deadly horn that is on the front of his head. At least, and last but not least, there's the deadliest of them all, the Cape Buffalo. Wait, the Cape Buffalo is the deadliest? When my brother told me that the Cape Buffalo is more dangerous and deadly than the lion or the rhino, I was pretty skeptical. And since it was my brother, I assumed he was pulling my leg. The big guy, the buffalo, not my brother, looks slow, and he looks sluggish. He looks lazy. He is closely related to the cow, for goodness sake. Who would ever think a cow could earn the name Black Death? But the Cape Buffalo isn't the only animal that kills the most people. The hippo is responsible for that because he kills villagers and natives as they wander along the river. The Cape Buffalo has secured his moniker Black Death because he kills over 200 hunters each year. In other words, the Cape Buffalo is a warrior. When he is under attack, he does not retreat. He fights back. When a lion is injured, he runs away. When a leopard is injured, he runs away. But when the hunter takes a shot at the Cape Buffalo, his aim better be true and his shot better be accurate, because if the animal is not dropped, he will turn the table and the hunter will become the hunted. The Cape Buffalo does not run away when from the enemy. He does what all of heaven's warriors need to learn to do. He charges towards the hunter with all of the power and courage and fierceness he has. The hunter soon finds that he has become the hunted. When heaven's warriors walk out onto the battlefield that exists between the realm of heaven and hell, we can do so with the same power and courage. Yeah. and deadly fierceness that the Cape Buffalo has. The Cape Buffalo is not afraid to fight back. If he gets hit, he gets mad, and he gets even. He teaches the enemy all about the meaning of the words regret and retreat. I am the first to admit I have lived most of my life thinking I was powerless against Satan and his evil ways. I live in fear of standing up to him, afraid to challenge him. I believe that his lies when he told me I was insignificant and that I am weak and that I am no warrior. But no more. When the enemy takes a shot at me, he better turn and run. I think all too often we forget how much power we have and how we run into the fear and how we run from the fear of Satan. But God has given each of us the power and the authority that we need to not only stand firm against the destroyer, but to turn and destroy him. Luke 10:19 says, I have given you authority over the power of the enemy and to walk among the serpents and the scorpions and to crush them. Nothing shall injure you. The beasts of hell are not to be feared. And if one gets lucky, a lucky shot in, and he knocks us down, then we need to take our next move from the Cape Buffalo playbook and circle around and run around as far as we can. And we need and meet him on the battlefield and fight.
When you leave this world behind you, it's what you leave. Don't want to bring them. Does anybody in here know sign language? Raise your hand.
A little bit.
Good, then you won't know when I mess up this night. Probably need to move this a little bit. Sandy?
Yes, ma'am.
Where are you? 2 weeks ago. Sit it down. Yeah. I became a Cape Buffalo.
Yeah.
Getting ready to became a lot more meaningful to me. You know, I'm gonna do the King is coming, but for some of us, the King's gonna come sooner than the rapture. It's all about the rapture. But just a few weeks ago, a young man left Purina, headed out to have his lunch. He was hungry. He was going for lunch. Got about halfway down that road. Somebody pulled out in front of him. His King came for him. You know, we don't know when the King is coming for us. But whenever it is, I'm excited about the King.
Yeah. Yeah. Right.
Pray for me and don't watch for my mistakes.
Coming, the King.
is coming for you, and you, and you, and you, just like he's coming for me. God bless everyone.
There is no good in me that is worthy of being on this stage to speak forth God's word. And to be honest, it's kind of scary, not because I'm in front of a lot of people, but because I have to answer to God. And God is my judge, and he takes this very seriously. And he's so loving. So I want to talk about the grace of God. And what better to start off talking about the grace of God than talking about the gospel? The gospel is that all of us, each person in this room, we were dead sinners at one point. We deserved God's wrath. We had committed injustice, and God, being a just and righteous God, was obligated to judge us for the wrong that we had done. And because of that, we were in danger. We were in danger of death and of inevitably hell. But God loved us enough to not want us to send us, to not want us to be there. He wanted us to be with him. He wants communion with us. And that just blows my mind. The person who spoke the planets into existence wants to be my friend. And I don't have the mind to fathom that kind of love. And, you know, God loving us that much, my mind goes to the vision that Isaiah had. In Isaiah chapter 6, it says that in the year that King Uzziah died, he saw the Lord high and lifted up, seated upon a throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple, and his glory was shown, and the cherubim were shouting, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." And we know in John's gospel that Isaiah was witnessing Jesus, King Jesus, seated upon the throne. And I want us to realize that one day, King Jesus, that the Lord was seated on his throne, and he got up out of his throne, and he walked down to earth, and he was born as a child, just like all of us were. And he grew up, and he became a man, and he preached, and he healed, and he brought forth the kingdom of God. And he wants to do that for us as well. And he was murdered willingly on our behalf. I mean, if you really study what crucifixion actually is, very, very painful death, and it's horrific. And he willingly gave himself up for that. And, you know, it says that he could have called down legions of angels to save him, thousands upon thousands of angels. But he loved us enough to die for us. And it says that he pressed forward for the prize that he was going to get. And that prize is us. He wanted us. And he loved us enough to do that. But he didn't stay there. 3 days later, he got up. And I found this out a few weeks ago. I read this verse where it says, when Peter got to the tomb, he saw Jesus' clothes folded up. Is anyone else just like surprised by the fact that Jesus folded his clothes when he rose from the dead? Okay. Like Jesus folded his cloak. Okay, anyway. Like the King of Heaven just rose from the dead, and he just folded his clothes. Okay. But he literally rose from the dead. I mean, he rose from the dead. And if that's true, if nothing else in this world is true but that he rose from the dead and that he died for us on our behalf, then nothing can hold us back. No sin, praise the Lord, no shame, no addiction, not even death itself. And because of that, it says that God highly exalted him, and he's the name above all names, and he has the authority to call each and every person in this room his friend, his love. He calls us redeemed, or his bride. And I'm so glad that God didn't leave us by ourselves. Because if he did, I mean, you know, we'd be in pretty bad shape. And so a definition of grace, you know, given from the gospel, is that God is giving us his goodness that we don't deserve. We do not deserve it. And I'll be the first one to tell you, we don't deserve it. And so if this is so true, if God loved us enough to do this, if he's that in love with us, and he gave everything down to his life for us, what do we do about it? I mean, we can't just be stagnant. And I praise the Lord because I have been stagnant in my relationship with him, and he's even more gracious than that. And it says in Romans, by the mercies of God, his mercy, present your bodies as a holy and living sacrifice. If he presented his body as a sacrifice for us, why don't we do the same for him? If he loved us that much, we should love him that much in return. And we'll never be able to process that kind of love. And that's just, that blows my mind about God, that he loves us that much. And another thing, he's so faithful. He's so faithful. That's the one thing about God that just sticks with me, how faithful he is. Because I've turned my back on God repeatedly. And God always calls me back. Always. He's never let me down. He has never left me by myself. I might have felt like I was, but he never left me there. He always came running back to me. And like I said, you know, Jesus gave up everything for us. And we need to do the same for him. And I mean, we have to think about that. Like, we have to give our lives to that. If he's that gracious, if he's that loving, how much more willing should we be to give back to him? And when I was writing down my notes for this, I was just thinking about the story of the prodigal. You know, he left his father's house, spent up all of his money, and wasted his life away. And it says he came to himself. He realized what he had gotten himself into. And I can only imagine what he was thinking in that moment. But he decided, you know, let's go back home. Dad might just make me a slave, but, you know, I'm still going back home anyway. And so it says that he was walking home, and his father from the house saw him from afar off. And the father wasn't angry, wasn't stubborn, wasn't doubtful of his son. He ran to his son, and he kissed him, and he hugged him, and he dressed him, and he put a ring on his finger, and he fed him. He threw a party for his son's return. And if you're out there today, if you're the prodigal, if you're the one who's ran away from home, God's telling you to come back. Like, he wants you to come back, not because he's a mean God that's going to send you to hell, but because he loves you, and he wants you. He wants to be with you, and I'm so thankful that he doesn't leave us by ourselves to fall into our own sin and to our own shame and just the problems that he saves us from. And he's so good, and just think about that. Like, don't leave the building today. Don't go out and eat today without thinking about the fact that we don't deserve to be here. And that's harsh. That's a very harsh message. But the gospel is harsh. And I'm so thankful that God doesn't neglect us. And he's so faithful. He's so loving. And so in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 and 5, it says, "But God being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even we were dead in our trespasses, dead in our sins, he made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved." And so it's only by God's grace. It's nothing that we could do. We're not faithful, he's faithful. And you know that verse in Timothy, I believe, it says, even we're unfaithful, God is faithful. And he loves us and he wants us. So just, even if you don't want him, because I've been there. I've been in that state where I didn't want anything to do with God. I knew the truth, but I didn't want a thing to do with God because I didn't like the way that he did things. But and that's how I know that it wasn't me that saved myself, because I didn't want a thing to do with God. He called me back to him. So just think about that. Like, he's so forgiving and willing, and he loves you and he wants you. Thank y'all.
What a great job, Cody. We're proud of you. Give him another cheer. See, if you don't come up here, it looks easy from down there sometimes, doesn't it? Well, God bless all of you. I'm going to try to share a song, but I'd like to translate it for you first, if I may. This song says, "My soul blesses you, O God, because you are so good to me. Your blood flows through my very being, and your love has filled me up within. My God, I'm asking you, please, don't ever take your hand off my hand. To be walking with you is better than life. It's better than life. My heart knows that you are my everything. It's simple. Oh God, you are my everything, and in your presence, there's fullness of joy. In your presence, there's delights in your right hand. Forever and forever, I rejoice in your presence. My desire is to look for you each day and night, to see your love and the tenderness of your spirit, Lord. That's my desire, to see you day and night, to see your love and tenderness of your spirit, Lord." You will not understand these words unless you're fluent in Spanish, so I gave you a little heads up, but would you just worship the Lord with this song? God bless you. Dios le bendiga.
Es mejor.
justice and instead of God. The presence of God is in this place today. Thank you, Jesus.
In the presence, I plenty good they call so in the presence. Por siempre y para siempre, yo me gozo en tu presencia. Make it better. En tu presencia, I plenitud de gozo en tu presencia. Delicias.
Dios, tu bondad no comes.
tus manos está. Desde el momento del desierto hasta el yo cantaré de la manera de Dios en mi vida.
Do you know when a pastor says, I got a small message?
Quiere decir?
It means?
Nada.
Nothing.
So Someone say, God, help our pastor. I want to talk to you for just a few minutes about this subject. Prepare before the rain. In the book of Genesis, chapter 6, verse 11, the Bible says, now the earth was corrupt in God's sight, and the earth was filled with violence.
Y se corrompió la tierra delante de Dios y estaba la tierra llena de violencia.
Verse 12.
Versículo 12.
And God saw the earth.
Y Dios miró la tierra.
And behold, it was corrupt.
Y aquí estaba corrompida.
For all the flesh had corrupted their way on the earth.
Porque toda la carne había corrompido su camino sobre la tierra.
Do you remember this story?
¿Se acuerdan de esta historia?
Do you remember the story about Noah?
¿Se acuerdan de esta historia de Noah?
Someone can say amen.
Alguien diga amen.
Verse 13.
Versículo 13.
And God said to Noah, I am determined to make an end of all flesh, for the earth is filled with violence through them. Behold, I will destroy them with the earth.
Dijo pues Dios a Noé, he decidido el fin de todo ser, porque la tierra está llena de violencia a causa de ellos, y he aquí que yo destruiré con la tierra.
Make yourself an ark of gopher wood, make rooms in the ark, and cover it inside and out with pitch.
Hazte una arca de madera de gofer, harás aposentos en el arca, y calafetarías con una rueda por dentro y por fuera.
Unas palabras difíciles.
Very difficult words.
Yes. Why did God want to build an ark?
¿Por qué quiso construir una arca?
Does anybody know?
¿Alguien sabe?
I'm sorry? To save them?
¿Para salvarlos?
From what?
¿De qué?
Why did God want them to build an ark?
¿Por qué querían que
construyeran? Because it was going to rain.
¿Por qué iba a llover?
Verse 17.
Versículo 17.
For behold, I will bring a flood of waters upon the earth to destroy all flesh, in which is the breath of life under heaven. Everything that is on the earth shall die.
He aquí que yo traigo un diluvio de agua sobre la tierra para destruir toda carne en que haya espíritu de vida debajo del cielo. Todo lo que hay en la tierra morirá.
So if you read chapter 6 in Genesis,
así que si leen el capítulo
6,
versículo 22,
sí. If you read chapter 6 in Genesis,
si leen el capítulo 6,
you'll see that God gave Noah a lot of instructions.
Mirarán que Dios le dio muchas instrucciones a Noah.
Exactly what to do.
Y exactamente qué hacer.
Exactly how to build the ark.
Cómo hacer la arca.
So we're going to skip ahead to verse 22.
Vamos a brincar al versículo 22.
Someone say praise the Lord.
Alguien diga alaba al Señor.
Y lo hizo así Noé.
Noah did this.
Hizo conforme a todo lo que Dios le mandó.
He did all that God commanded him.
He obeyed the Lord.
Él obedeció.
We need to prepare before the rain.
Necesitamos preparar antes de la lluvia.
Prepárate antes de la lluvia.
Prepare before the rain.
Not after the rain.
No después.
Pero antes de la lluvia.
But before.
God told Noah to build an ark.
Dios le dijo a Noah que construyera una arca.
A big boat.
Un barco grande.
So Noah followed God's plan.
Así que Noé siguió el plan de Dios.
And he built a boat that was 1.5 football fields long.
Y construyó un bote que tenía un campo de fútbol y medio de largo.
Qué grande.
How big.
That's a huge boat.
Es un barco muy grande.
Noah's neighbors laughed at him.
Los vecinos de Noé se rieron.
Because there wasn't any water in the desert where they lived.
Porque no había agua en el desierto donde vivían.
Doesn't that sound crazy?
¿Eso se escucha loco?
Many believe there had never been rain.
Muchos nunca han creído que hubo lluvia ahí.
Study that sometimes.
Estudia eso unos días.
It's an incredible study about science.
Es una estudia mucho de ciencia.
So Noah had been told by God there was going to be a flood.
Así que Dios le dijo a Noah que iba a haber mucha lluvia.
I'm not sure Noah knew how it was going to happen.
No sé si Noah sabía cómo iba a pasar.
But God told Noah that a great flood was coming.
Pero Dios le dijo a Noah que iba a llover.
Noah tried to warn the people to change their ways.
Noah quiso advertir a todos para que cambiaran.
So they could hear God too.
Para que escucharan a Dios.
But they wouldn't listen.
Pero no escuchaban.
They just kept on with their selfish life.
Ellos siguieron con sus vidas egoístas.
Escúchame.
Listen.
It wasn't raining when Noah built the ark.
No estaba lloviendo cuando Noé construyó la arca.
Do you hear that?
¿Escuchas eso?
It wasn't raining when Noah built the ark.
No estaba lloviendo cuando construyó la arca.
Now we don't know how long it took him to build the ark.
No sabemos cuánto duró para construir esa arca.
Some say 120 years.
Unos dicen 120 años.
Most scholars say it's probably closer to somewhere between 40 and 70 years.
Muchos dicen como 40 o 47.
That's a long time to be building something.
Eso es mucho tiempo para construir algo.
To protect yourself from the rain.
Para protegerte del agua.
When there's no rain.
Cuando no hay agua.
But the point is,
pero el punto es,
we need to prepare before the rain.
Necesitamos que preparar antes de la lluvia.
No estaba lloviendo cuando Noé construyó el arca.
It wasn't raining when Noah built the ark.
Noah and his family and his animals lived in the ark for 7 days before the first raindrops fell.
Noé y su familia, a los animales, vivieron en la arca durante 7 días antes de que cayera.
And then it rained for 40 days and 40 nights.
Luego llovió durante 40 días y 40 noches.
Soon the earth was covered with water.
Pronto la tierra estaba cubierta en agua.
And after it stopped raining,
después de que llegó lluvia,
does anyone know what happens after the rain?
¿Saben lo que pasó después de que llovió?
The water has to go somewhere.
El agua tiene que ir a algún lado.
Have you ever had any flooding in your house?
¿Se ha inundado en tu casa?
I don't know the Spanish word, but we have a sump pump in our basement.
Tenemos una pipa abajo del sótano.
Because sometimes when it rains,
porque a veces cuando llueve,
and the water begins to soak into the ground,
y el agua empieza a meterse al suelo,
it finds its way into the basement.
Se encuentra con el sótano,
and it rises.
Y sube.
After this rain,
después de esta lluvia,
the water continued to rise for 150 days.
La agua siguió subiendo por 150 días.
Altogether, Noah and his family and the animals lived on the ark for 1 year, 1 month, and 27 days.
En total, Noé y su familia y los animales vivieron en la arca durante un año, un mes, y 27 días.
What a quarantine.
Qué cuarentena.
Ahora yo tengo una pregunta.
Now I have a question.
What if Noah had waited until it started raining to build the ark?
¿Qué pasaría si Noah esperó a que lloviera para construir la arca?
What if he had waited?
¿Qué pasó si esperaría?
You can't wait until it's raining to get ready for rain.
No puedes esperar hasta que llueva para estar listo para llover.
Have you ever been unprepared?
¿Siempre has estado no preparado?
I remember one time.
Yo me acuerdo un día.
When my son was young.
Mi hijo estaba pequeño.
And we were in the mountains of North Carolina.
Estábamos en las montañas de Norte Carolina.
And it looked like rain.
Y se miraba como iba
a llover. But we didn't prepare.
Pero no nos preparamos.
And so we kind of went through a trail.
Así que caminamos un camino.
Got farther and farther from the car.
Nos fuimos más lejos del carro.
Anybody want to guess what happened?
¿Quieren adivinar qué pasó?
Yes, we got wet.
Nos mojamos.
It rained.
Llovió,
and it rained,
y llovió,
and it rained,
y llovió,
and it rained,
y llovió.
So finally I said,
y hasta que dije,
you two wait by the tree,
esperen aquí en el árbol,
and I will run back to the car,
y yo voy a correr al carro,
and get an umbrella,
y voy a agarrar un paraguas.
It was too late then.
Era muy tarde.
My wife looked at me like I was crazy.
Mi esposa me miró que estaba loco.
You know why?
¿Saben por qué?
Yes, but I was crazy. Hablando naturalmente,
naturally speaking,
si sabe que va a llover, prepárese o mojese.
If you know rain is coming, get ready or get wet.
Those are your choices.
Esas son tus opciones.
Now, rain can be good or bad, right?
La lluvia puede ser buena o mala.
So get prepared.
Prepárese.
Sometimes rain is good, it's just what we need.
A veces la lluvia es buena, es lo que necesitamos.
Sometimes we don't want it to rain.
A lo mejor no queremos que llueve.
Someone said one time,
¿alguna vez alguien dijo?
Don't wait until you're thirsty to dig a well.
No esperes a tener sed para cavar un pozo.
You know why?
¿Saben por qué?
You're too weak.
Estás muy débil.
If you wait until you're thirsty to dig a well,
si te esperas hasta que estés sediento,
then you start digging the well.
Empiezas a escarbar,
and you don't have the strength.
Y ya no tienes las fuerzas
to reach the water.
Para alcanzar la agua.
Don't wait until you're thirsty to dig a well.
No esperes a tener sed para cavar un pozo.
Don't wait until the rain to prepare for the rain.
No esperes por la lluvia para prepararte a la lluvia.
Do you believe God is a good God?
¿Crees que Dios es un Dios bueno?
We sang about His goodness. We sang about His goodness.
Cantamos de sus bondades.
Do you believe He's a good God?
¿Crees que es un Dios bueno?
Do you believe God knows what you need?
¿Crees que Dios sabe lo que necesitas?
Do you really believe that?
¿Crees en eso?
If you believe God knows what you need,
si crees que Dios sabe lo que tú necesitas,
wave your hand at me a little bit.
Levanta la mano.
You see this, God?
¿Miras esto, Dios?
We believe that you know what we need.
Nosotros creemos que tú sabes lo que necesitamos.
Do you believe God is going to send us showers of blessings?
¿Crees que Dios nos va a enviar lluvia de bendiciones?
I preached a few weeks ago.
Prediqué hace unas semanas.
That I hear the sound of the abundance of rain.
Que escucho el sonido de la abundancia de lluvia.
I think God is getting ready to bless us.
Creo que Dios está listo para prepararnos. Para bendecirnos.
So get ready.
Así que prepárense.
Get ready.
Prepárense.
Get ready.
Prepárense.
Prepárate.
Get ready.
Get ready.
Prepárense.
God is going to bless us.
Dios nos va a bendecir.
You prepare before the rain.
Prepárate antes de la lluvia.
So how can we prepare?
¿Cómo podemos prepararnos?
Get your heart ready to receive from God.
Pon tu corazón correcto para recibir por Dios.
You have to do like Noah did.
Hazle como Noah.
It doesn't make much sense, God.
No tiene tanto sentido.
But I know something's going to happen.
Pero yo sé que algo va a pasar.
So I'm going to get ready.
Así que me voy a listar.
I'm going to pray.
Voy a orar.
I'm going to read the word.
Voy a leer la palabra.
I'm going to fellowship with other believers.
Voy a estar con otros creedores.
And God is going to rain on us.
Y Dios hará llover en nosotros.
You believe that? Say amen.
Si crees en eso, diga amen.
Ladies, would you come? Gracias, Brian. How about a cheer for Brian? Doesn't he do a great job?
I've been wandering through the desert. Ain't seen a cloud in forever over me. But I believe your rain is coming. Yeah, I've been hanging on the high hopes. Cause you're the one who's making dark holes come to life. You're the light I put my trust in. And the word you say is gonna come true.
it wonderful to be in the house of the Lord today? Give the Lord another cheer. He's worthy. I'd like to thank everyone that took part. Thank you for Brother Tony and the sound booth keeping everything together. Thank you to my son for organizing this program. Thank you to you for being here today. And so now, the next thing on program is after we talk about the goodness of God, we get to rejoice together as we enjoy a meal together. So before we do that, I'd like to ask the Lord to bless the food. Pablo, necesito su ayuda, por favor, aquí. I need your help here just one moment. Pablo is practicing his English. Pablo está practicando su inglés. And I'm practicing my Spanish. Y yo estoy practicando mi español. So we have fun when we're together. Cuando estamos juntos, we enjoy that, right? Claro. Sí. So I was wondering if before we go eat, if you would say a prayer and ask the Lord to bless the food. ¿Entiendes?
Yes.
Por favor.
Señor, te damos gracias por este servicio, Padre Santo, Padre Hermoso. La comunión de tus hijos es muy bella y muy importante,
Amén.
Señor.
Amén.
Te damos las gracias por lo que ocurrió hoy en este día, Señor. Algo hermoso preparado para ti, mi Dios. Porque tú miras, Señor, a tus hijos unidos como una sola carne, Padre Santo. Bendice los alimentos, Señor, en el nombre de Jesús, aquellos que pudieron traer, Señor. Súpleles cada día más y más, Señor. Gracias por este convivio, Señor, que lo llevaremos a la cocina, Señor, Padre Santo, y estaremos juntos, Señor, porque tú en la unidad derramas bendición y vida eterna, Padre amado. Gracias, Señor, y esta semana la declaramos victoriosa en tu nombre, amado Dios, por tu sangre, por tu amor y tu misericordia. Y esperamos tu venida, Señor, con ansia. Ayúdanos a prepararnos, Señor, y bendiga estos alimentos y esta comunión en el nombre de Jesús. Todos decimos,
Amén, Amén. Thank you. Please stand. You can exit out those doors. Keep walking. Go toward the smell of food. Okay. God bless you.